is the one. Okay, good. So, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for making your time this late. I know it's been a very long day of conferences. I hope you guys took good advantage of the day. It's always a pleasure to be in here and to meet some usual people. And for us, it's great because we have the opportunity. It's a perfect timing because it's just when we release our SoccerX transfer review report, which we've been doing at Primetime Sport since 2009, and it's normally right after the summer transfer window. Some of the things that you will see are things that you will have read in the media already, but basically what I want to do is to take you through the main conclusions of what we've seen in the transfer market window this summer. There's plenty of interesting things for us to discuss together, so I'll just take the word, go through that, and then obviously we'll have an open conversation. So, transfer review, SoccerX transfer review, as I said, we've been doing it twice a year since 2009, summer transfer window, winter transfer window, and what we do is we review the transfer activity, the player transfer activity across the top five European leagues. And obviously when we've done it for so many years, it's good because we can have a very nice perspective, and as you will see with the numbers, we're lucky to be all together involved in such a dynamic industry. And this year in particular, we have seen a number of events and circumstances that made this transfer window a very special one, a very unique one. And I would highlight two of these circumstances. The first one is the new TV deals cracking in this year at the Premier League. We are talking about a combined revenue for the league over the next 3 years of £8.3 billion. This is more than 50% above the previous deals. And this is something that, as you will see in the numbers, has definitely affected positively the purchasing power of the English Premier League clubs. Not only this year, but even the previous year when these deals were announced, even if they still would not be in place. So that's one circumstance that has impacted dramatically the market this summer. The other circumstance, I would find it at La Liga. So La Liga, we've been seeing year after year the fact that it was a duo competition, Barcelona versus Real Madrid, and then everyone else. There's been a turning point at La Liga since the current regime driving and managing the tournament have managed to go through a law, which meant the end of the individual sales of the TV rights, in a way that now the sale is collective, and it's much more spread. So La Liga went from, you know, seeing Barcelona and Real Madrid at €140 million each in revenues from TV rights per year, compared to, you know, the Eibars or the Alaves or this type of club, Granadas of the world. This world are around €10-15 million, so it's sometimes 12-13 times from the one making the most to the one making the least. We've seen a big turnaround here because the new system, the new regime, the new way of both selling the rights and, more importantly, distributing the rights means that Barcelona and Real Madrid have accepted to stay in similar numbers so that the increase in value of La Liga went spread into the other teams, which means that effectively, for the first time, we've seen the small teams having a purchase power to buy players that we've never seen before. So these are the two circumstances that have clearly affected the market. The market, as you know, has been awesome and whopping numbers. You know, we're talking about here €3.3 billion in transfer expenditure. That's 9% above a year ago, and it would be even more if we wouldn't have seen the impact of the devaluation of the British sterling. And if we look at this per league, it's no surprise that the Premier League is more than ever the driving force of European football. What happens in the Premier League impacts dramatically the other leagues, and some of them, like the French one, have become, you know, a product suppliers or have become player suppliers for this very strong league. So basically 1.4 billion euros, record high in history, just like last year we saw record high in history too. And then followed by the Italian Serie A. We've been seeing a lot of activity at Italian Serie A, but as you'll see later, this is something that has been dictated and driven by the fact that there's been a lot of sales, player sales, and that has been reinvested in new players. So the order this year in terms of amount spent, Premier League, different animal, and then Serie A, Bundesliga, La Liga, and League One. So that's in terms of amount spent. If we go deeper and we look at the, you know, second tier division in the different leagues, we can see also another piece of information, a piece of news, which makes England even more different than the other countries. And when we see that Championship in the EFL has spent almost 250 million euros in new players, and we compare with the other leagues, I mean, there's just no comparison. This is driven by the fact that we've got, you know, this year we've got at the Championship teams like Aston Villa, Newcastle, teams that are traditionally at the Premier League, and they have parachute payments, they have available income to invest, and basically they want to invest very hard, not only those teams but any teams in the competition, just to basically promote and have access to the big money that participating in the Premier League brings along. In terms of player sales, and this is also very important because we like, as you know, to talk about net spenditure, which is basically what you spend in new players after deducting what you have cashed in terms of player sales. So that's what I was mentioning before. Italian Serie A, driven by many transactions, mainly obviously, you know, the Pogba sale from Juventus to Manchester City, Manchester United, Higuain being sold from Napoli to Juventus. So the numbers from the Italian Serie A are mainly driven by high amount of sales that have been then reinvested into player acquisition. So all in all, when we made the net calculation, the dominance of the Premier League is even more dramatic, you know, and we look in 790 million euros net investment, which compares to Bundesliga 84 million euros. So big dominance by the Premier League. We've seen it year after year, and this year in particular, for a combination of factors. On one side, obviously, new money coming in from the TV rights, but then also the fact that some of the big teams are coming from a bad season. Manchester City, new project, new manager, Manchester United the same, Chelsea the same. So all the big teams have been in bad need to improve pitch results and have spent big time. In terms of the big spenders, we are in the city that has spent the most this summer. So both Manchester teams have spent more than any other teams in Europe. Manchester United has spent 185 million euros, followed by Manchester City with 174 million euros. Then other team, Juventus, also because they've been reinvesting some of the money that they've made. All in all, 5 in 10 teams in the top 10 in the Premier League. So again, big dominance from the Premier League. Three of the teams that have spent most this summer have joined the historical top 10 of maximum expenditure in a summer transfer window, which is still led by what Real Madrid invested in the season 09-10, where they invested almost 300 million euros. In terms of player sales, we've got some usual suspects in here, starting with Juventus selling for 159 million euros, Valencia 113 million euros, Dortmund, very, very intensive activity, And then some of the teams that we are used to see in this top 10, Sevilla will have the opportunity to comment with Ramon, still in the top 10 every year, selling big amount in new players and bringing in new players and repeating it again the following year. Very, very, very impressive. Even Liverpool has now been featuring among those clubs that are selling and making a lot of money in player sales. Liverpool has sold over the last 3 years for €274 million. So big, big amount. And then if we put together the amount of activity, including both sales and expenditure, Juventus is probably the, not probably, it's definitely the team of the summer in terms of the activity. It has definitely been very busy at the Juventus Stadium with all the players leaving, all the players coming. Big, big amount of money, transactions in total for more than €300 million. The names we're all very familiar with, the highest transfer in history, Pogba moving to Manchester United, going back to Manchester United, Higuain, whopping €90 million, and then many, many other players. Surprisingly, we haven't seen Real Madrid doing any big transaction this summer, and this is not pretty much the usual thing. So, two of these, the top two transfers of this summer, Pogba and Higuain, joined the historical top 10 of most expensive transfers ever. Another interesting development that we've seen, and obviously we'll have the time to talk about Sam Allardyce, he's in the news today, as we all know, for non-football reasons, if we can call it like this. But something that we have started to track, because we're seeing it more and more, is when teams have to pay a fee to count on a new manager. So Everton has paid a lot of money to Southampton, just like the FA has paid a lot of money to Sunderland to be able to land Sam Allardyce as the England manager. So we've been tracking this activity, and more it's happening that not just the players, but the managers have become also a kind of trading good in the industry, which makes it very, very interesting. I don't want to go into too much detail, but I have some details to share about both La Liga and Premier League. Soccer Transfer Review is always going out with two different editions, La Liga and Premier League edition. And I just want to share a couple of circumstances or news about both La Liga and Premier League, which will help us to have a discussion afterwards. The news at La Liga is this kind of new democracy that I was talking about. More income going into the smaller teams, which means that when we started doing our report, only 20% of the transfer activity would be made by teams other than Real Madrid or Barcelona. Only 20%. This summer, two-thirds of this activity has been done for teams other than Barcelona and Real Madrid, which is precisely one of the objectives of La Liga by centralizing the rights. Also very interesting, it's very small in here, but I just want you to keep some numbers in mind. Six teams at La Liga have managed to spend €30 million or more in new players. This is something that never happened before. 10 teams investing more than €10 million in La Liga. Again, something very usual, as we'll see in a second, in the Premier League, but not that much in La Liga. So as a result, we've seen, you know, never before we've seen this amount of expenditure. You know, 2 years ago, only 4 teams spent more than €30 million, only 7 teams spent more than €10 million, only 7 teams spent more than €5 million. Just like this summer, we've seen 15 teams spending more than €5 million, or only 4 being able to spend €2 million or less. So, a turning point in La Liga, plenty of information that goes in this direction. The bottom 10 of teams investing has basically, this summer, has invested for €43 million. This is 2.5 times the amount that we saw the last year. And if we take the top 4 teams is investing again. We're moving from almost 90% 2 years ago into 66.3%. So this is a big change at La Liga. This is something that we will be able to discuss at the panel and obviously take questions from you guys. But one of the objectives that La Liga has with this new system is to have a more even competition, to have more less predictable results. And it seems to be working, because when we look at the first six match days in La Liga, we realize that Barcelona and Real Madrid have dropped more points than ever before. I read the other day that since is the year in which the leaders have collected less points for the last kind of 10 years. So it seems to be working. So and actually you could expect Barcelona and Real Madrid to drop more points than ever before and to lose more often. Probably you will still see them winning the tournaments, but I'm quite certain that we will see them losing more matches than ever before. Probably not at the level of competition that we see here in the Premier League, but definitely becoming a much more attractive proposition. Then some data and facts about the Premier League that can help also our panel discussion. The trend, it's unbelievable the way it's been growing. Record high investment year after year, as we commented before. All the teams have spent 30 million or more, which is unbelievable amount. And more importantly, 13 out of 20 teams have made this summer their record high signing ever in their history. So plenty of different activity. What we also see is the fact that if we look at the top 10 most expensive players of the summer, only one striker features in the top 10, Batshuayi, that has been brought by Chelsea from Olympique Marseille. Four centre-backs are in the top 10 in England. So centre-backs have become very precious trading good in the industry. And it's interesting to consider this information for us to discuss. But then you need to ask yourself, when you see this amount of money being spent, is it money that is properly spent? Is it paying off? You know, because sometimes you feel like, even as fans, we may ask ourselves that we don't understand some of the signings. Here are some numbers that can bring food for thoughts to all of us, right? On one side, we see that over the last 4 years, there's been 124 players that have been bought by Premier League teams for 10 million euros or more. Okay, out of these 124 players, only 52, 42% of them, have played more than 50% of the minutes, which means that almost 1 billion investment has gone to players that either are not regulars in their team or have even left their teams. Because if we go deeper, we'll see that only 34 of these 124 players, so 27% of these players, are still in their clubs right now, since they came to their team. So that means that 600 million worth of players, we could consider that they would not work. Right, and then every case is a different one, but at the end of the day, the number is that 20%, 22% of the investment that the Premier League has done in new players, it's been done in players that are no longer in the team that they brought them in. So again, some more information, some more food for thought. Some of the names here, obviously Di Maria was only 1 year at United, Benteke, who is doing, by the way, quite well at Crystal Palace, etc., etc. Finally, another interesting question or debate, and it's still probably too early to say, and we'll have also the opportunity to discuss later on, is Brexit going to affect the way the market works, the way the Premier League teams invest in new players? If we look at this summer, the answer is it looks like it's not going to be the case, okay, because English teams have spent or have invested in foreign players more than ever before. And out of these 1.2 billion players that have been bought by English Premier League clubs, most of them are players that are currently in kind of European passport holders. And depending on what the ultimate regulation is, they may not be eligible for Premier League teams in the future. We'll see. So, just again, some final conclusions here. As I said before, Liverpool and Southampton have become regulars in terms of selling players, and Liverpool is doing quite well, by the way. But this is something that we've been seeing since we've been doing the report, especially since the implementation of financial fair play. The trading of players has become a standard practice, not only in the Sevillas, Southamptons, Benficas, or this type of teams, but also in the top teams, just like Liverpool is. So these are the numbers that I wanted to share with you. This is something that we will now be able to discuss more in detail. And I'll just finish my presentation with kind of four open questions for us to discuss together. First one, an obvious one, is there a limit? What is the roof? What will happen next year? Will we see English Premier League investing more and more again? Is it going to flatten? What's going to happen? How are the other leagues going to compete with this? How La Liga, La Bundesliga, Serie A will manage to retain talent and compete effectively with the English Premier League? Is Brexit, when it officially going ahead, is it going to affect the way the European market works, especially with the dominance of the Premier League? And then another interesting thought for us to discuss, based on what I was commenting before on, is like, are we going to see regularly or soon a team or a side which is not Real Madrid or Barcelona winning the Premier League? Sorry, not the Premier League, that's not going to happen. But is it going to happen that a team which is not Real Madrid or Barcelona wins La Liga? Who knows? We've seen it with Atletico recently, and maybe with a new distribution it may happen more often. Let's see. So this is just some open questions that we can just now discuss together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Seba. Thank you very much for making